call the room to order. This meeting of the Common Council for Monday, March 20th, 2023 is now in session. Could I have a motion to approve our agenda?
Move to approve.
Second.
All right, please vote. I'm waiting.
Motion to, do you want to make it, Sue, or you want me to?
I'm sorry, for what?
For, to do your add-on?
You can go ahead.
Okay. I move that we add ordinance D-266723, sponsored by Councilor Finkham and Hannan, to add-ons on under 15.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion?
Mr. President?
Yes.
Would you like me to read in the memo for our?
Please.
Dear council members, we'd appreciate the approval of you, our fellow council members, to add ordinance D-266-23 to this evening's council agenda. This ordinance establishes a paid living donor leave for eligible full-time City of Carmel employees. It's important to add this ordinance on tonight's meeting's agenda because there is a current city employee who is about to make a living organ donation. Passage of this ordinance tonight will ensure that he receives paid living donor leave while he is recovering from the surgery. We would appreciate your consideration adding this item to the council agenda.
All right. If this passes, this will become item 15A on our agenda. Please vote. And that motion carries.
Move to approve as amended.
Second.
All right. Is there any discussion? Please vote. Okay, that carries. Thank you. We will deal with that under item 15. Next, I would ask Pastor Joe Smith from Northview Church to please come forward for our invocation.
Joe, please bow your head with me. Let's pray. Dear God, we just approach you during this time and just ask for your guidance, your direction, and your wisdom. We love and care for this wonderful city and the people within this community, but not as much as you do. So we just ask that you would direct this meeting, all of the conversations, the agendas, and all the plans moving forward. And of course, we also ask for your protection over our families, over this council, over our city leaders, first responders, our medical workers, and everyone is so dedicated and works so diligently to make this city the best it can possibly be. Thank you so much for the life that you give us. Help us to not take any day on this earth for granted. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. If you'd please rise for our Pledge of Allegiance.
Councilor Nelson.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, at this time, I am actually happy to welcome some members of Carmel High School from the Health Occupation Students of America as outstanding citizens. I'm going to put you under this category. So we have Catherine, Nisha, Isha, and Andy are here, I believe. So it's very interesting. This, the HOSA, and if you can go ahead and take your place right up here and get ready while I give you a little introduction. The HOSA Club at Carmel High School reached out to me regarding heart health. And so they have done some work as part of their club, and they are required to share that with the public. And this seemed to be like a great place to do that. So with having said that, I welcome the four of you to the Carmel City Council.
Thank you so much. Good evening, City Council members. Today, my team and I will be presenting about cardiovascular disease and heart health. According to the CDC, the number of teens 12 to 19 years old who are diabetic or pre-diabetic has jumped from 9% in 1999 to 23% in 2008 in less than a decade. What is more troubling is that diabetes is one of the controllable risk factors for cardiovascular disease, meaning more teens of this generation are at an increased risk for heart attack or stroke than any other generation.
Cardiovascular disease rates have been growing alarmingly quickly, yet preventative measures can be implemented to prevent further cases.
What is coronary artery disease, also referred to as CAD? When someone is suffering from CAD, the heart is not getting enough oxygen, nutrients, or blood because the arteries that supply the heart are too narrow. There is reduced blood flow to the heart, which may cause common symptoms, including chest pains and shortness of breath. When your heart cannot supply enough blood to meet the body's needs, an individual may feel especially tired. CAD can also lead to further cardiovascular issues. The building of excess fat and plaque along the artery walls is known as atherosclerosis and can lead to an artery becoming completely blocked and can then cause a heart attack.
So what's going to put some at higher risk of coronary artery disease than others? As people age, there's an increased risk of narrowed and damaged arteries. Men are also generally more susceptible to coronary artery disease, but women have increased risk after menopause. Lifestyle choices, including smoking, unhealthy diet, low amounts of sleep, and alcohol use are significant risk factors of developing coronary artery disease. These four factors can lead to unhealthy weight gain as a result of not exercising on a consistent basis. Other risk factors include stress, family history, and chronic kidney disease. Oftentimes, risk factors will cluster together, and one risk factor may lead to another. For example, high cholesterol and high blood pressure can lead to diabetes, which is a symptom of coronary artery disease.
Another factor that puts many at severe risk for CAD is an unhealthy diet that consists of high levels of salt, added sugars, and saturated fats. Some common examples you might see include mac and cheese, fried chicken, and sweet tea. These foods significantly increase one's risk of hypertension, which can lead to cardiovascular disease.
This issue specifically is prevalent in Black teens. Dr. Porter, a nephrologist at Mayo Clinic, states 41% of African Americans can have high blood pressure, compared with the 27% of their white counterparts or Caucasians.
Additionally, research suggests African Americans may carry a gene that makes them more salt sensitive, increasing the risk of high blood pressure and heart disease. This explains why African Americans are disproportionately affected by obesity. Yet by moderating the approach of a diet and eliminating one high-risk food at a time, significant changes can be made to help reduce the risk of developing serious cardiovascular conditions.
There are many factors that can contribute to a healthy heart lifestyle that everyone can take to reduce the risk of developing severe coronary artery disease. One that is often overlooked is finding healthy outlets for stress. While stress in our lives is often unavoidable and it can contribute to bad habits that affect heart health, it is important to find healthy outlets to this stress, such as exercise or meditation.
The earlier you begin developing healthy habits, the more you can prevent the risk of developing coronary artery disease. One of the key risk factors for heart disease is smoking and tobacco usage. Secondhand smoke is also an increasing concern in the United States, and many people don't realize that secondhand smoke can be just as harmful as directly using tobacco products. Quitting smoking can be done through a state hotline or through different medications and programs.
As we mentioned earlier, an unhealthy diet that consists of high levels of salt, saturated fats, and added sugars adds to your risk of developing CAD. To reduce the risk of developing a major cardiovascular disease, individuals should aim to eat more foods that protect the heart, that are lower in fats and sugar and higher in fiber. Creating an eating plan can help one stay on track and maintain goals of healthy eating. Food deserts impose a further risk on those living in lower-income communities. For the purpose of this presentation, food deserts are defined as areas in which at least 100 households are located more than 1/2 mile from the nearest supermarket and have no vehicle access, as defined by the USDA. Funding needs to be concentrated in these areas that are more heavily affected by lack of access to healthy food. The populations in these areas then resort to the nearest gas stations or other small stores that do not import fresh fruits, vegetables, or other healthy meals.
One of the harder factors to maintain is a consistent exercise routine. In order to develop a healthier heart, we need to not only become active, but stay active. Just 150 minutes of moderate exercise a week has been shown to significantly reduce rates of coronary artery disease. It is recommended to visit a doctor before starting a new workout plan, but the benefits help your heart stay actively healthy.
The preventative actions mentioned above all represent ways an individual can keep their heart healthy, but the problem stems from other factors as well. School lunch options are one of the biggest drawbacks for children and teens in school.
Items on the menu are typically high in fat and calories, which can contribute to weight gain, thus making more people susceptible to CAD in the future. According to the CDC, an estimated 17% of children and adolescents aged 2 to 19 are obese.
There are several changes that can be made to existing menus that, while are little, can make significant difference in the lives of teens. Requiring fruits and vegetables for students increases the amount of healthy nutrients they are consuming. Limiting the amount of dessert a student can purchase, things such as ice cream and cookies, including less fried foods and carbs, and making more protein-centered meals are all potential initiatives for schools everywhere.
Organizations that would help increase accessibility to healthier options include the Summer Food Service Program, the National School Lunch Program, and the Community Eligibility Provision Program. These interventions all provide healthier food options to teens and communities that struggle with high rates of cardiovascular disease should focus and emphasize the importance of maintaining a healthy heart.
Our heart health is essential to many other components of life and contributes to our overall health and well-being. Lifestyle changes and community efforts can reduce the risk of developing conditions like hypertension, coronary artery disease, and ischemic stroke.
As we conclude this presentation today, it's important to take away that maintaining a healthy heart is both a personal responsibility and a community effort. Individuals need to find ways that they can reduce their own risk by improving their lifestyles, but community programs, especially those in schools, should provide members of the population with adequate nutrients. Thank you.
Very good, very good. Would each of you please introduce yourselves, give us your full name, and would you then tell us why you are a member of the Health Occupation Students of America?
My name is Catherine Key, and I joined HOSA because I wanted to learn more about what it's like to work in the healthcare field and also do research about various diseases and conditions.
Thank you.
My name is Andrea Bendeley, and I joined HOSA because I'm really interested in the medical field and I wanted to learn more about different aspects that all go into medicine.
Thank you.
My name is Isha Singh, and I joined HOSA because I find that as a child, you don't really understand what the medical field is about, and I really wanted to get a better feel of what I'm putting myself into in the future.
My name is Anisha Singh, and I joined HOSA because I found that it was a great way to do research both on my own and in interactive ways about the medical field.
Very good. And I will tell you, they took this presentation very seriously. We had meetings in advance about this, so thank you for your work. I do want to give the council a chance to ask any questions. If anyone has any questions, okay. Very well done. I think you should get a round of applause.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for being here. I'm going to move on to our next agenda item. This afternoon at 1:30, there was a presentation at the Indiana Senate. Concurrent resolution number 18 was presented to Mayor Jim Brainerd. And I was asked to read this into our record, so I'm going to do that. But I do want to thank right now our State Senator J.D. Ford, and also Senator Scott Baldwin for both sponsoring this resolution. I know the mayor was touched by it. So if you'll please indulge me for a minute. Senate Concurrent Resolution number 18, honoring Mayor James Brainerd for his 27 years of service as mayor of Carmel, Indiana. Whereas Mayor Brainerd was first elected mayor of Carmel, Indiana in 1995. Whereas during his time in office, Mayor Brainerd oversaw Carmel's tremendous growth and prosperity with a population that increased from 25,000 to over 100,000 in the last 25 years. Whereas Mayor Brainerd prioritized economic development and initiated several special projects that contributed to Carmel's rapid progression to a city consistently ranked as one of the best places to live in the United States. Whereas Mayor Brainerd transformed downtown Carmel into a vibrant public space with the development of the city center, Midtown, and the Arts and Design District, which includes world-class cultural entertainment venues such as the Hotel Carmichael and the Center for the Performing Arts, consisting of the Palladium, a 1,600-seat concert hall, the Tarkington, a 500-seat proscenium theater, and the 200-seat studio theater. whereas Mayor Brainerd implemented numerous environmental initiatives, most notably the construction of more than 140 roundabouts that reduced vehicle emissions and enhanced the safety of drivers and pedestrians, which led to Carmel's first place award in the Climate Protection Awards from the U.S. Conference of Mayors. Whereas Mayor Brainerd directed the expansion of Carmel's green space with an increase of more than 800 acres of parks and trails, including an extension of the Monon Trail and development of Central Park, resulting in Carmel earning recognition as the national runner-up for the Home Depot Awards of Excellence in Community Trees. And whereas Mayor Brainerd's leadership and ambitious vision have promoted a beautiful city that facilitates community engagement, attracting entrepreneurs and small business while fostering a neighborly environment where Hoosiers are proud to live and raise their families. And whereas Mayor Brainerd leaves his post as mayor of Carmel, Indiana, after 27 years with a legacy that forever transformed a city into a spirited and welcoming home, and one that will continue to serve as a guiding example for leaders of communities and cities across the state. Therefore, be it resolved by the Senate of the General Assembly of the State of Indiana, the House of Representatives concurring, the Indiana General Assembly honors Mayor Jim Brainerd for his 27 years of service as mayor of Carmel, Indiana. That occurred today at the State House, and I think that deserves a round of applause as well. So thank you to Mayor Brainerd. Are there any other recognition? Is there any people that wish to address the council? Okay, the clerk has none. Are there any council or mayoral comments? Seeing none, we will move on to our consent agenda, the approval of minutes. March 6, 2023, our regular meeting. And we also have claims in the amount of payroll, $1,136,078.42, and $3,489,483.48. General claims in the amount of $6,669,328.53, and retirement in the amount of $106,146. Wire transfers in the amount of $2,196,005.70.
Move to approve.
Do I have second. A second? Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Please vote. Kevin, I need you to vote. Okay, very good. That passes. We will now move on to mayoral vetoes, which we have none. Committee reports, Finance, Utilities, and Rules Committee. We have one item on our agenda. However, we have not met. We're not prepared to meet yet. I will let everyone know when a meeting is scheduled. So we'll move on to Land Use and Special Studies Committee.
Thank you, Mr. President. We met last week to discuss Z681-23, and I'll give a full report when we get to 12A.
Thank you, Councillor Campbell. All right. We also have a report, a special report. I'm excited about this one, from the Humane Society of Hamilton County. Thank you, Rebecca. Yeah, if you would go ahead and the mic is on.
It's on? Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for having me here today. Sue, thank you for inviting me out. It's been a while since I've had an opportunity to meet and present to the council, so I really appreciate the chance to speak with you and get you up to speed with what's happening in our world at the Humane Society for Hamilton County. There's a lot going on in our world. As I assume most of you know, we moved into our new state-of-the-art facility. It's actually 2 years in April that we will be in that facility. It has proven to be a dream come true, as we had always expected, but as with all things, the universe has ways of throwing you curveballs. And one of those is definitely the number of incoming dogs that we are seeing right now is unprecedented. We built a facility with research and did studies to ensure that we would have space through ideally 2036. And I can tell you as of right now, we have dogs in every cage, every kennel, every visiting room, every office in our building. It's certainly not something I ever expected to see 2 years into a brand new facility that offered us a great deal more space. And so I think the message that I definitely want to share with you guys tonight is that your Humane Society is in crisis. And it is more important now than ever before that we get the word out to the community, every municipality, the entire county, to let them know that we currently have almost 300 dogs right now in our care, from puppies to seniors. Many owners surrendered is what we're really seeing. Some 14 years old surrendered by their families after they've been with them their entire lives. And those are things that are shocking, and it's hard to believe someone would do that, but unfortunately they do. And we are there as an open admission facility 7 days a week, 365 days a year, to take them in and give them the best chance that they have to find another home or to end their life with dignity. And we are putting out urgent pleas to everybody to please consider adopting from us. I want to thank you, Woody, for your recent adoption. I appreciate it. I'm working on Sue. You're all on my radar. No one is safe. I know where you're at now. But in all seriousness, even fostering a dog for a couple of weeks is what we're asking people to consider, because frankly, it's down to the fact we're counting cages every day, kennels every day, to make sure we have room for the day's arrivals. And they come every day. So if you can jump on our website at hamiltonhumane.com, there's a list out there of every dog and cat that is available for adoption. Most are available for fostership. And like I said, it sounds like I'm selling cars. We've got big ones, small ones, medium ones, every breed, you name it, we've got it. And don't think for one moment that if it's a pure breed that you have your heart set on. I have a shelter full of them, and it would shock you to see the dogs that I have available for adoption. I have two purebred collies that look like they belong at Westminster coming in a week. So please, don't visit Uncle Bill's. Stay away from Petland. All bad. Thank you, Adam, for leading that fight and being the first one to do it, and Carmel being the first city to approve it, by the way. Congratulations. They deserve an applause for that, because that's not easy to do. It's not a popular thing, and I appreciate that, and a lot of people do. And so with that, I just want to open it up to any questions you might have about our relationship or when you can come in and pick up your foster dog.
Thank you. Thank you for that report. I'll go to Councilor Austin.
Thank you, Mr. President. First off, thank you for all you do. And, you know, I love your facility. It's disappointing that we're already at the point, but I understand during COVID, a lot of people thought getting a dog would be fun. And then when COVID passed and they go back to work, now they're realizing they don't have time, which is, you know,
and
very disappointing.
It's interesting leading off of these young ladies right here. Did you know that having a pet reduces your blood pressure, anxiety, and stress? Did you know that's a proven thing?
It also makes neighborhoods safer, and it's not necessarily because you need a big, vicious dog. It's because walking the dog around the neighborhood is the best neighborhood watch.
We need volunteers to walk dogs so your heart's healthy and you get plenty of exercise. See, I didn't even know this was going to be perfect tonight.
Exactly.
And then the most remarkable thing about animals, especially the ones you rescue, because they know and they appreciate it, is that they actually can heal broken hearts. And I've seen it. So it's pretty cool that you were here today.
So, Rebecca, two things I want to touch on. One, you mentioned, you know, the ordinance that Carmel passed, and we were the first. But unfortunately, due to a law that is making its way through the State House, we could be the last and only city in Hamilton County to have an opportunity to reflect their residents and to make a decision when it comes to whether or not they want to pass ordinances with pet stores. The Indiana State Legislature has decided that it is not up to the local governments to make that decision. And they would grandfather in Carmel, but a piece of legislation that keeps making its way through. And I encourage anyone that cares to please contact their state representative or state senator, because Fishers, Noblesville, Westfield, I'm not saying they have to pass a similar ordinance as Carmel, they would not have the option.
Right, because House Bill 134?
Senate Bill 132.
132, okay.
Yes.
So, yeah, that's definitely something we're trying to get the word out about here. And keep me posted on when we can rally the troops. That's one thing I'm really good at doing.
And second, say somebody, they already have too many pets in their mm-hmm. house, but they want to support you. I hear you accept money too, right?
It's true. It's very true.
What are other ways people can help?
Well, of course, right now, in all honesty, I mean, we always need money, but I need dogs to go into homes urgently. Number one, volunteering, fostering, we are hiring. There's all kinds of opportunities to get engaged with the Humane Society. There's never a shortage of need. So the best thing to do is to get on the website at hamiltonhumane.com and everything out there about how to volunteer, how to sign up. We have our Director of Development out here with me today, Jenny Hatcher, who handles the volunteer program. So if you have any questions after the meeting, she can help you out, or I'm happy to. But this is definitely a team effort. Being a no-kill shelter is something that people in the Hamilton County community are very proud of. They embrace it, but it doesn't happen just within our walls with our people. It happens because the community is invested in coming and picking animals from us first and giving them the chance they deserve. This is a community collaboration, and we can't do it by ourselves. And the last thing I tell people is, just because we are a no-kill shelter, just because the human beings that work there and the volunteers are so deeply invested in these animals that they never give up on them, doesn't mean that the animals don't give up.
Okay.
So that's some, you know, they still need everybody's help. So right. I didn't get a chance. Woody, I wanted to thank you for your support too. You've been unbelievably helpful, saving our day at our fundraiser last year, and just the donations from Divvy that you send to the shelter, all the little things you do. We know it, we see it, we appreciate it, and congratulations on your appointment to our advisory board.
Very good. All right, Councilor Ryder.
I'm gonna give you a plug. My wife can't volunteer though. That's why we started the dog menu at Divvy, and all that money mm-hmm. goes to you guys. Because if she volunteers, I'd have to buy a farm. But when we decided, we always got puppies and we always have three small ones. And when we decided on the last one, we said, we're going to start doing the best of the rest. And I called you and said, do you have any small senior dogs? Her name is Raylene. We call her Ray Ray. She is the best dog I've ever had. Mm-hmm. And we got her, she was 13. She is 13. So I recommend to people, senior dogs. I mean, she was homeless. Like, I think you found her down on 86th Street. We thought she was a tan dog. After we got her cleaned up, she has a cow print. She's black and white. She is an amazing dog. So I recommend people come and get a senior dog.
Thank you.
We call it the best of the rest.
They are the best. You know, there's nothing like coming home and having someone think that you hung the moon and the stars every day.
She's waiting at the door when we come in. So.
Mm-hmm. All right. Councilor Hannon.
Again, thank you for your work. My wife used to volunteer there. Now she's busy with a therapy dog and hopefully a second therapy dog, too. Councilor Austin brought it up. Certainly, I and I'm sure others have heard people who adopted animals during the pandemic, just like they bought RVs and of turning them in. You mentioned that the demographics when you built this was good through 36 or something like that. Is there any thought, again, not to take away from your current crisis, which we feel and we understand, but is there any thought that some of this will ease and the numbers will get a bit better?
I pray so every day. I mean, I've never seen anything like it. I've been doing this for 18 years. I've seen a lot, and I've never seen this many dogs coming in. I do think we're still seeing some COVID backlash because a lot of shelters were giving away at the curb, like literally to anybody for free. Some of our shelters in central Indiana, Indianapolis, are giving them away for free. And when you don't have any skin in the game, and when you don't have a decent reviewing application process, than what I see, which is disheartening and frustrating, and something I've actually gone to Commissioner Airbrant to help me navigate, is that we're seeing people adopt a dog from Indianapolis, for example, 2 days later, because there are apartment restrictions, because they didn't get along with their dog, or it's not good with a kid, and there's no review process, they're bringing it to me. And they can if they're a Hamilton County resident. So, you know, that's one of the sticky points of, you know, our design is we are open admission to all Hamilton County residents. That's the best way to do it. But right now, I'm seeing too much of that. And so I'm working on a plan to make it a little more difficult for people to dump their pets on my doorstep and to do that particular thing. But to take on Indianapolis, which is the government IACS animal shelter, I'll probably need some political help to do that. So I'm going to, that's where I'm going with this, because it's out of hand, it's out of control, and, well, I don't do well with that. So it's on my radar for sure.
All right. Okay. Thank you very, are there any other questions? Councilor Finkham.
You brought it up earlier about our relationship. Can you explain to those who aren't familiar with it how you help the city of Carmel manage
Sure.
lost pets and
Yeah.
other issues?
So the Humane Society for Hamilton County, longer than I've even been here, serves as your animal control facility. So unlike other communities like Indianapolis that I brought up, they have an animal control facility that's government operated, fully taxpayer dollar funded, and then there's a private Indy Humane, Indianapolis Humane Society. They're two different entities. And Indy Humane is select admission. They don't have to take anybody in if they don't want to. We're designed to be everything in one. We're your Humane Society, we're animal control. We take it all from every municipality, from the Hamilton County Sheriff's Department. We're a one-stop shop for everything animal in our county. That's the best business model. That's definitely the way to do it. And in order to make it a win-win for everybody, our ordinance requires that we hold strays for 7 days in hopes that an owner will come forward and claim them. What the city of Carmel, Fishers, Noblesville, Westfield, Hamilton County Sheriff's Department pays is basically the funding for those 7 days. Basic sheltering, overhead, lights on, only direct cost of animal care, people included, no cost of marketing, no cost of programs, no cost of fundraising, not even life-saving care in those first 7 days is covered by anybody but the Humane Society. So it's literally 7 days in a cage until they become ours on day eight. That represents approximately 20% of our overall annual operating budget. Collectively across all of the municipalities. So it's good. Another day, we'll talk about it being more, but I do think there's some opportunities there and some ways that we could get some additional help for being the remarkable organization that we are. We're one of the best in the country. We're one of five that's actually open admission and no kill in the United States. National awards, programs that we deliver and offer the community that are unheard of from an animal shelter, like our veteran program. At-risk youth, seniors, animal shelters don't do that, but we do. And so it's a lot of great services that we're offering. But that's how we work, and that's how you guys don't have to operate your own animal control, and you don't want to. Trust me, it's not for the faint of heart.
We appreciate you. We mm-hmm. really do. Thank you, Rebecca.
Mm-hmm.
I appreciate you being here. Thank you to your team and all that you do
for
Hamilton County. We are grateful to you.
I appreciate your support, and I'll see you next week. I got dogs picked out for each of you already.
Okay? All right. Okay.
Thank you so much.
We will move on now to item 12, which is old business, second reading of ordinance Z681-23, which is an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, amending the 146th Street and Keystone Avenue Planned Unit Development District, which is Z344,
Sponsor is Councillor Austin. This is returning from the Land Use and Special Studies Committee. Councillor Campbell.
Thank you, Mr. President. This is coming back with a 4-0 unanimous positive recommendation. We discussed a couple of things. We discussed traffic, which came up during the meeting when it was introduced. And the petitioner's traffic engineer is here if anybody has questions, because I believe it was just the committee who attended. There weren't additional counselors. There are several conditions that we also approved, so this ordinance has been amended. And Steve Harden is here. Steve, if you would come up to the podium, and if you want to read into the record the conditions and explain why the conditions are now part of the ordinance.
Great, thank you.
It'd be helpful.
Good evening, Mr. President, members of the City Council. For the record, my name is Steve Harden. I'm a partner in the law firm of Fagery Drinker, with offices located here in Carmel. And thank you for the invitation to come up and speak for a moment. But before I do that, the two remaining students here, I wanted to affirm you. You guys did a great job. Obviously, you did a great job researching. Your presentation skills are awesome. It's very encouraging to hear you guys. So congratulations. Well done today. Appreciate that. So we did, when we had our homework when we were here last time, was to be prepared to focus on traffic and then the fuel and the protections with that. So we had our two experts. Steve Fairbach is here this evening on traffic. If you have questions for him, and then our expert on the fuel was Jason Carr. He had a medical procedure today, so he is somehow magically up on that screen if you have any questions, and I'll do the best I can to summarize what we said, and if there's further questions, we have both of them available. First off, on traffic, we explained that early on the team met with the city and the county on the traffic issues. The county has the jurisdiction over the 146th Street interchange in the city south of the roundabout. The team met with the county particularly to address the queuing issue that currently exists out there at the intersection today. And then they were tasked with coming up with some recommendations. So Steve Fairbach and his firm at A&F Engineering provided recommendations to the county. The county's experts then reviewed those recommendations and agreed with them. They then encouraged them to then present that to the county commissioners, who then also further reviewed it. And then they unanimously approved those recommendations at Kite's and BJ's expense. And I apologize, I jumped right into affirming the students, and I forgot to tell you who else is here from Kite and from BJ's. With me here tonight is Mark Jenkins and Gene Byerman from Kite. They've been working, they're the ones, when we mentioned, have been working with the county all this time as well. Then Alan Fedhajic, the civil engineer from Kimley Horn, is here. Mark Leach, our planner from our firm, and then Mark Lavoie from BJ's is here if you have any questions for them. And Steve Fairbach and Jason Carr are also available. Then what the county then did is when they approved it, they wanted us to make sure that we incorporate that into the PUD ordinance. So those specific requirements are in the PUD ordinance, have been reviewed both by the city engineering department and the county, and those have been incorporated into the PUD ordinance. With respect to the fuel station, what I think it was Councilman Green who asked the best questions, I think, to kind of sum up at the committee meeting. He asked, after the experts went through with all the different protective measures that were being undertaken for the fuel, first off, it was clarified that, yes, the city leadership from the very beginning said, look at what we've done before and use the Rickers at 146 and River as an example. Use that as your starting point and then work with the city engineering department and stormwater team to relook at that and apply it to this project. And so then as we went through all of the different things that are in the PUD, no, it's okay, it's not showing up here, but in the PUD ordinance we have a whole series of requirements, and then the additional conditions which we just talked about are also, were in your packet that were circulated probably a week or so ago, and I can read those into the record here, but the key question I think Councilman Green asked was, are these the normal types of things that you do in other projects across the country? That was asked of the consulting expert who does has a national practice, and he said no. He said, nowhere else in the country do we do anything like this. Everything that's in the PUD ordinance and in these conditions are above and beyond. This is more than a gold standard. I think that was important to have mentioned that at the committee meeting for the record, and we just would share that again with you here. The industry has requirements. There's regulations of what you're doing when you're doing a fuel station. So all these conditions or things that are incorporated into the PUD ordinance as well as in the condition are all above and beyond. And I think that was important from the city team and the leadership requiring those. Did you want me to actually read this into the record? Okay. So we have a condition F. These are conditions to enactment of ordinance Z68123. The following are imposed as conditions to the enactment of this PUD amendment ordinance Z68123, the PUD amendment ordinance pertaining to the real estate, and are hereby referenced as Exhibit F, the conditions. If any condition conflicts with provision of the PUD amendment ordinance, then the more restrictive shall apply. Condition one, additional automobile filling station protection devices. In addition to the protection devices listed in Section 2.1 of this PUD amendment ordinance, additional controls shall be installed as noted on the fuel containment concept plan in Exhibit F1 attached hereto and incorporated herein, the fuel containment concept plan. Condition two, groundwater monitoring program. The automobile filling station shall adhere to a groundwater monitoring program acceptable to Carmel Utilities if deemed necessary by Carmel Utilities. Condition three, protection devices design. The automobile filling station protection devices shall be designed to treat and contain pollutants from the fueling operation prior to entering the overall water quality and detention system for the remaining parking lot and building. And then we attached the concept plan that was referenced. And in advance of the committee meeting, John Thomas from the city departments sent an email, I believe is included in your updated materials as well, a week or so ago, that confirmed that they were in full agreement with this and asked us to incorporate this into the ordinance as we've done. Thank you very much.
Okay. Councilor Hannon.
Yeah, Mr. Harden, thanks for being here. For the benefit of the council and particularly for anybody viewing, could you go through specifically the traffic mitigation strategies that are going to be? I think I can see it here in the diagram, but it's small, and I don't know if there was a blow up. And my interest is because I see this on a daily basis living in that area right now, the queue is problematic. And if BJ's is successful, and we certainly hope they are, it's only going to make that worse. So if you or somebody on your team could go through specifically what those mitigation sure. strategies are, and hopefully with some illustrations just so everyone can see.
Sure. We'd be happy to. Steve Fairbach is making his way up. He's got a piece of paper. Do you want me to put this on?
Oh, you got to. Yeah.
Yep.
Hi, I'm Steve Fairbach with A&F Engineering, office at 8365 Keystone Crossing. I'll go over three things that we're going to do. Sorry about the voice. I think I'm catching a cold. The first thing we looked at was the queue length, and what's occurring out there right now is the queue backs up almost all the way to the roundabout during the PM peak hour. So right now in the northbound direction, you can see on the drawing on the screen, right now that is a right turn lane only, and what we were asked to do is take a look at if we move that to a through and a right turn lane, what that would do. And that reduces the queue back towards the roundabout by almost 100 or less feet of queue length. By doing that, we have to go across the street and modify that pork chop, I call it, or that median there. So the lane would actually continue through through Greyhound Pass, and that would be one that the county commissioners agreed to. And in fact, the county engineer said we probably should have done that years ago, to be honest with you. So that was one of them. The other thing we did was we took a look at the roundabout, and we wanted to make sure that people could get out into the roundabout when volumes increase right here. So what we're doing right here is we're adding an extra lane that is a right turn lane, slip lane we call in our industry, where if people get in that lane, they'll be able to go southbound onto Lowe's Way and then move to wherever they need to go after that. That's going to increase the capacity of that roundabout quite a bit. And finally, at the very end, we're putting a right out only at that location so that people that want to go south and they don't want to get into the roundabout can do that. By doing this, one of the things the city engineer asked for, Jeremy Cashman, was we have got to put a raised median in here right along Lowe's Way, and so people can't go backwards into the site. And that's under design in our office right now, and he hasn't reviewed it yet, but we'll be able to do that because if you drive it, there's a really wide painted median out there. We're going to extend that median probably about 100 feet north of the driveway.
Yeah, and that'll help. So certainly one of the questions that you answered is the straight through, you're going to have to dig into that triangle or pork chop that you called it there. You said it would improve the backup by 100 feet, but is that at current rates? Because BJ's is going to add to that, right?
No, I'm sorry. That's with added traffic. We went through the study and we added their traffic onto that intersection and then ran the analysis.
Okay, thank you.
Steve, do you have a site plan that you could throw up there? I know that it's in all of our packets, but I think it's important that we just review where the gas station will be in proximity to the homes. What was the final plan? And if you just speak to that about the distance for anyone that might be watching or could not attend the Land Use Committee meeting.
If there's any way to, well, maybe we don't have to blow it. So here is a 500-foot line. So this is, in green is where the BJ store is, and then the filling station is down here in this area. So it's further away than the 500-foot line.
Okay. And is the law or the guidelines 500 feet,
yes,
is
sir.
That the norm? So we're doing better?
In Carmel,
yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we're doing better than the guidelines?
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. All right. Okay, are there any other questions? Oh, I'm sorry, Councillor Austin.
Thank you. This may be for John or Steve, but we've got Plan Commission tomorrow. This will go back to the Plan Commission now that it's been amended?
For DPA DLS, it will.
Okay, John, is this something we'll have to add to tomorrow's agenda because it's not on the agenda?
No,
it's just
conditions. No, we're just doing a condition of approval, so that doesn't have to go
when
back.
When the council adds conditions, if we had taken something away that they did, yes, it would go back. But when we can always add conditions without it going back.
Yes,
okay.
Sir. That's
just making sure we're good.
Thank you.
All right, are there any other questions? I'm looking for a motion.
Move to approve as amended.
Second.
All right, it's been moved and seconded to amend. As amended. Is there any discussion? All right, please vote. All right, that's approved. Is there a vote to approve?
That was.
Okay. Oh, as amended. Okay. Thank you. All right. We are done. We are going to resolution CC-0306-2301, a resolution of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, approving certain matters in connection with the Old Town Economic Development Area 1933 allocation area, sponsors Councillor Ryder. This remains in Finance, Utilities, and Rules Committees. Item 13, public hearings. There are none. New business. This is first reading of Ordinance D-2666-23, an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, amending Chapter 4, Article 1, Division 3, Section 4-26 of the Carmel City Code. Sponsor is Councillor Worrell. Do I have a motion to introduce?
Move to introduce.
Second.
Okay. The synopsis is to amend the fees to cover the cost of the Carmel Police Department to run a criminal history report for door-to-door vendor, employee, and agents. If you go to line 42 of the existing ordinance, the change is to go from $20, which is a standard, and this is for door-to-door vendors who must go to the police department and receive a permit. We want to remove 20 to offset and insert not to exceed. The reason for this is because there are some vendors nowadays where we have to go further than just your typical check that you can do online, and in order to get any information, it is costing sometimes up to $75. So what we want to do on this ordinance is to just recapture the actual cost of what it's costing our police department to make sure that the vendors and the door-to-door activities that are occurring in Carmel are safe. So I didn't drag the police department here to explain that to us tonight. I know we have John Oberlander, but that's the only change to this ordinance.
Mr. President.
Mr. Ryder.
I move we suspend the rules and act on this evening.
Second.
I'm grateful to you. Is there any discussion about suspending? All right, please vote.
The voting machine has ceased to be operating, so I will call the roll.
Will the clerk call the roll, please?
Councillor Campbell.
Aye.
Councillor Green.
Aye.
Councillor Ayers.
Aye.
Councillor Ryder.
Aye.
Councillor Worrell.
Aye.
Councillor Austin.
Aye.
Councillor Nelson.
Aye.
Councilor Hannon?
Aye.
Councilor Finkham?
Aye.
Move to approve.
Second.
All right. Is there any discussion? Call the roll, please.
Councilor Campbell?
Aye.
Councilor Green?
Aye.
Councilor Ayers?
Aye.
Councilor Ryder?
Aye.
Councilor Worrell?
Aye.
Councilor Austin?
Aye.
Councilor Nelson?
Aye.
Councilor Hannon?
Aye.
And Councilor Finkham?
Aye.
9-0.
All right, that motion carries. Thank you, everyone, for that. We will move on to item 15A, which is agenda and add-on items, ordinance D-2667-23, an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, adding section 2-59 to chapter 2, article 3, division 2 of the Carmel City Code. Do I have a motion to introduce?
Move to introduce.
Second.
All right. Who would read the, Councilor Finkham, would you please read the synopsis?
The synopsis for this is that this ordinance, as we discussed earlier in the memo, just establishes a paid living donor leave for eligible City of Carmel employees. As we mentioned earlier, the backstory on this, Mr. President, is that a couple years ago, I had requested with the HR director at the time to put this in place because we had an employee who was a living kidney donor. We felt this was a right thing to do, and many employers already do this. Somehow in the process, not all the I's were dotted and the T's were crossed, and this really wasn't instituted. So we had an employee want to utilize the policy. It wasn't in place. This employee's had a complete workup, is ready to donate, and is on hold until this is put in place. So I'm asking your indulgence this evening to, first of all, hopefully support this, and second of all, to pass it on first reading.
Yes, and I would note you have gathered support from the mayor, from human resources.
Yeah.
In my opinion, you've done your homework.
Yeah.
All right. Are you ready to take questions?
Absolutely.
All right. Are there any questions?
Mr. President.
Councilor Ryder.
Move we suspend the rules and act on this evening.
Second.
Right. Okay. Is there any further discussion on suspending the rules?
Mr. President.
Councilor Finkham.
One note, because we're all here, we don't have to do a we can just do a voice vote, not a roll call.
Okay.
That's true.
Very good. But isn't it more fun to do? It's more fun to do the roll.
It's up to you. You're the president.
I like the roll. Let's do the roll. All right. Will the clerk please call the roll? Indulge me.
Councilor Campbell.
Aye.
Councilor Green.
Aye.
Councilor Ayers.
This is to suspend.
Councilor Ryder.
Aye.
Councilor Worrell.
Aye.
Councilor Austin.
Aye.
Councilor Nelson.
Aye.
Councilor Hannon.
Aye.
Councilor Finkham.
Aye.
9-0.
Okay, that passes.
Mr. President.
Councilor Finkham.
Move to approve.
Second.
Thank you, Councilor Finkham. Is there any discussion? All right, please call the roll.
Councilor Campbell.
Aye.
Councilor Green.
Aye.
Councilor Ayers.
Aye.
Councilor Ryder.
Aye.
Councilor Worrell.
Aye.
Councilor Austin.
Aye.
Councilor Nelson.
Aye.
Councilor Hannon.
Aye.
And Councilor Finkham.
Aye.
9-0.
Councilor Finkham, thank you for doing this. I know that there are at least two people who benefit from this, so thank you. And there will be more.
Yeah, of note, 17 people die every day waiting for an organ that did not arrive in time. So the fact we have an employee who's doing an amazing altruistic donation, and this donation to someone he does not know, so it's clearly an incredible donation. The least we can do is make him not use his time.
Right.
So thank you for passing this evening.
Yep. And of course it is private, but maybe someday we'll be able to thank you. All right.
Mr. President.
Yes.
Make sure before you leave, the Humane Society left all these things. She asked that you grab one of each of them, please.
Okay. And I'm looking quickly. Do we have any other announcements? Any further business for the good of the order? We'll get Councillor Green out of here on time. We are adjourned.